Hi, it's Seta here. In this video, I will show you how to use a technique known as Occlusion Culling. So if you want to boost your game performance by rendering only what's necessary, then this video is for you. But before we move on to the tutorial, I would like to remind you that until the end of this month, you can still buy my drag and drop volumes at the lower price. With the new update, drag and drop volumes will include another 10 volumes with ready-made lighting settings and post-processing from my speed design videos that appeared on my channel. With every next update, the list of available settings will be expanded to include additional volumes. So now is the perfect time to buy drag and drop volumes at the old price before it goes up. And now let's move on to the tutorial. As I mentioned before, occlusion culling is a rendering technique used to improve performance by not drawing objects that are hidden from the camera view by other objects. Imagine that you are walking through a city, and if you are standing in front of a tall building, you can't see the smaller buildings that are directly behind it. In the context of video game, there is no need for game to render those hidden buildings, because they aren't visible to you. That is where occlusion culling comes into play. It divides the scene into smaller fragments and then checks whether the given cell is visible by camera. If the cell is visible, then objects within it are visible too. If not, they remain hidden. It helps game engine avoid wasting resources by not rendering objects that the player can't see. Now let's jump into Unity and see how to enable occlusion culling. I prepared this small scene to better show you how the occlusion culling works. So first, let's open the occlusion culling window, go to the window, rendering, and select occlusion culling. Now we have this new window and you will find three tabs in there: Object, Baked, and Visualization. So let's start with the Object tab. Here you can specify which object in your scene are static and should be considered for occlusion culling. If we select Object or Objects, we can make it occluder static. That means that this object can hide other object depending on the camera position. When we select Occlude Static, then that object can be hidden by other object, but cannot hide other object themselves. That means that all objects that are occluder can hide occlude objects, just as wall hide everything in the buildings. But if we look through the window, in this case the window will be occlude object, the entire room will be visible. In general, small objects are usually used to be a occlude because they are rarely cover other objects, where big objects like walls are used as occluders. And remember that a dynamic game object can be a occlude at runtime, but it cannot be a occluder. In the object tab, we also have occlusion area. Thanks to it, we can create area on the scene that inform Unity that it might be worth checking more carefully which objects are visible and which are not. We can create such a zone by clicking Create New Occlusion Area or create a new game object, select Add Component and type Occlusion Area. Then we can set the boundaries of such a zone. And thanks to this, during baking, our occlusion area will be divided into smaller cells, where the entire surrounding outside this area will be divided into larger ones. If we don't designate such areas, the entire terrain would be divided into smaller cells, which would increase baking time and size of the occlusion data. So, by using occlusion area, we can determine where accuracy should be greater and where it can be less. It is useful mainly inside the buildings, where we have more object than outside. Of course, if we want to add more such as zones, we can do it by adding a new occlusion area. Now let's move to the bake, and here we have three options. Using smallest occluder, we can set the size of objects that are intended to block the visibility of other object. So if we set a value here, for example 0.5, then all objects that are larger than this value will be taken into account as occluder and hide other object. Smallest occluder determines also size of the cells. A smaller value increases precision, but also increases the size of the occlusion data. So it is worth using the previously mentioned occlusion area to avoid generating small cells across the entire scene. The smallest hole options allow Unity to ignore very small holes in occlusion culling process. This avoids rendering objects that are not visible through very small holes, which is usually unimportant to the end user, but it can increase performance. A higher value for this parameter means that the smallest hole will be ignored and objects behind them will be invisible. A lower value allows for a more detailed assessment, which might be needed for scenes requiring high precision. Using backface threshold, we can set whether we want occlusion to ignore the backface of object when generating occlusion or not. As a reminder, backface refers to the backside of the polygons in the 3D models. The front face is the one that is visible when looking at the model from the outside, while the backface is the one that faced in the inside of the object. If we set the backface threshold to 100, then the backface will be taken into account when calculating occlusion, which increases occlusion data size. If we reduce this value, we determine what percentage of backface can be in a given cell. I actually recommend leaving this value at 100 unless we want to reduce the occlusion data size in a very complex scenes. Then we can try to reduce this parameter. Now let's move on to the visualization tab. And this tab allows us to precisely test how occlusion culling works in our scene. When enable camera volumes, we can see yellow lines indicating the area for which Unity has generated occlusion culling data. And you can also see gray lines that indicate the cells. When visibility lines is enabled, we see green lines showing what the currently selected camera can see. Enabling portals show lines representing connection between cells in the occlusion data. So thanks to those three options, we can test if the occlusion system works properly for our scene. Lastly, I want to mention occlusion portals. To add occlusion portals, first add a new game object, then add a component and type occlusion portal. Now you can change its position and boundaries. An occlusion portal is a specific box-sized component that can be marked as open or closed. If it's open, the dot volume does not act as an occluder, and when we close it, then it acts like an occluder and can call object behind it. So this portal are like dynamic occluders that can't be moved, but it can be turned on or off. This is useful in the rooms where we have doors that we want to be occluders, but after opening them, everything in the other side should be visible. You can do it by a simple script. And that's all for this tutorial. I hope it was useful for you, and if you have any questions, feel free to write them in the comments below. And until next time, see ya!